moderator, whose currently character of the 70 museum in Germany is one of the
and energy, meaning the values and significance from the local place and the form from the people who directed the world together, and of course they reflect the issues of the moment in the art of times. That's one of the excitements of Biennale, that one is looking at very contemporary art from the period that the exhibition is held in. The Asia-Pacific Trend of Contemporary Art, which I refer to as APT, was founded by the Queensland Art Gallery of Brisbane as a museum-based Biennale project. I see also as a Triennale. And its focus has always been the art of Asia and the Pacific, including Australia and New Zealand, but excluding the Americas, and in recent years it's expanded to West Asia and the Middle East. It's a little unusual in that it's a museum-based exhibition, but as a museum person, my feeling is, as John Rosenberg has noted, museums can be very radical instruments for social change. And I think that a museum can also be a good place for a Biennale type event. Many artists don't have to work within the structures of a museum, but of course there are advantages in the strong resource base, the library and other archive resources, the large staff, which is always, I think, needs to be committed to the project. But the journal is also unusual in that it has a very extensive acquisition and commission program, and many of the artworks that I have going right on the screen that are part of the collection of Queensland Art Gallery. And it is quite significant, not 20 years of collection now in Asia Pacific art. In speaking of the APT today, I do so as one of the artists and project director for 10 years, so therefore I suppose from the inside perspective on the earliest of the APT, but also as someone who has watched the development of the APT from the outside for the last 10 years of academic at the Australian National University. And I might also mention that there are many young figures in this room, such as Hanmo and Eric Rosaka, who are also involved in the APT project. So this time, of course, Charlie Chalcott did a lot of decorations here, was an artist in one of the early APTs. The APT for us was largely a step into the unknown, because we were the first Australian institution or museum to make a significant commitment to advanced resources programs to create energy for the contemporary part of our region. So historical Asian art has always been appreciated and collected in Western countries, including Australia, where there are wide collections of Asian art from historical periods. But there was little knowledge in the late 1980s and 1990s when we were putting together the triangle of the dynamic and exciting contemporary art in the region. Now, the groundbreaking City Biennale, which I think we're talking about next, founded in the 1970s, was and is an absolutely critical art exhibition to all of us in Australia, and to me was a very special important part of my own involvement in art. It was founded in the 1970s and had always shown some Asian art, but its focus was not Asia, but the world and connected Australia too. When I'm sitting in this conference, I feel a sense of wonderful nostalgia because I have been to many conferences that have discussed the art of this region, and I was part of the 1997 Rockefeller Foundation Asian Society conference in 1997 that was held in Malaysia and Italy. Now, that was only 15 years ago, but there were very few representatives from Asia at that conference, and that is something that could not happen now. I think 1997 was a real turning point in art in the history of the United States. There's also a known by Cyber Chung at that very useful room, and quite humorous work at the Venice Biennale, the Dragon Standard, which some of us will remember. And I think that was a time when, although that particular conference criticized the lack of representation of Asian and Latin American and African artists in world Biennales, it was a tipping point when that changed. As indeed the world has changed, as we heard from verse 1. Earlier, the world has been changed very dramatically with its shifting gravity towards Asia. And I think myself that it's not just because of geopolitical and economic changes, it's because there is now such an important dynamic art discourse coming out of Asia that I believe is affecting and changing world art discourses. And I think myself also that it's sometimes very difficult for some of the young people to really think back. The domestic nation city travel in the early 1990s, this seemed to be a radical project to focus on the region, and in fact some people in Australia were skeptical of this attempt in the region. I just want to make the point that there were a large number of mothers in Australia involved in the early triennials and apprentices, and projects began to develop in the 1990s, such as ARCS, the Asian projects, the Museum of Contemporary Art, Sydney and Harding's Museum, Horatio Park, Victoria Lynn's Indian Exhibition in Niagara and New South Wales. But we felt there was a need for a very broad, wide-ranging exhibition focusing on the exciting part of the Asian Pacific region. In the first three triennials of training selected on our cross-cultural curatorial teams, we were experts from countries across the region, and that was the basis for selection, although that changed in 2002. I think those were essential, although they are sometimes criticized as being committed to high structures, as being very important for networking and building knowledge base for those three triennial exhibitions in 1993, 1996, 1999. The MET was changed and transformed by those collaborations with hundreds of experts and artists, and especially by the intellectual and artistic input of the artists in those debates. The voices of the artists were and are fundamentally into the process of what we do in these variation exhibitions. And I think one of the most important things about the MET was that we were able to bring so many artists to Australia, that they were able to spend quite a long time in residencies, to engage with local audiences, and also therefore to produce an interactive, logically, in words which are really related to place. And I think this is a tremendously important part of the BNI project, that it must connect with the local audience to the place, as I mentioned before. And certainly, as Nicola Joseph said about the APT, local audiences in Brisbane and Queensland, and I actually suggest straight away, really took this project to their hearts. And I suppose then the other important factor about the Asian Pacific Triangle, which may seem rather strange, was the inclusion of Indigenous art from Australia and the Pacific, which made the MET very engaged. I certainly mentioned that the Pacific BNI was in the forefront of introducing Aboriginal Australian art into the BNIs. But the inclusion of the term Indigenous arts certainly enriched our exhibition, and certainly enriched the discourse of our exhibition. And I would also say that the MET has given many opportunities to artists in poorer countries, particularly from one nature and another nature, whose work was not so often shown in this type of exhibition. Now, our key objective from the beginning was to provide a series of exhibitions, so we committed to three exhibitions over 10 years, although originally the budget for the exhibition was simply not established. Significant funding from the government and other sources, but it really wasn't in the dark in terms of budget. But a key objective was to provide a series of exhibitions that would educate Australian audiences about the dynamic changes in the Asia Pacific region, and at the same time connect with emerging events about the nature of contemporary art and writing in the changing world. Today, as issues of whether there could be such things as global art history, on this, such as Greece, Seehofer, Strasbourg, Nuremberg, Germany in July, and a situation where the nature of discourse as to whether contemporary art is and can be an art of the entire world, whether us can speak to each other across these types of exhibitions. I think this aspiration bringing us to a region together still has a validity. We hope to provide a forum for the discussion of new approaches to art as well as for experimentation, presentation of diverse ideas about art. And from the earliest day, it became apparent that Euro-American exchanges needed to be challenged as part of this process and were challenged at the AMT forums, which in the 1990s were very large art conferences by Australian standards of artistry and public Australia. And in this sense, the AMT, I think, was open to the future and will continue to eventually engage sense of what art is and will become and will become. And that's why I think the answer to whether originally the question about the MET is still open is that it can produce very important issues very significant utility in the original place. So I think the painting was and still is being transformed by ideas of artists and values that was from the region, and voices of the region have not always been optimistic about the future, but they have indicated a genuine belief which I'm proud to share in the role of art and artists in connecting and sustaining communities, especially in times of now that is sometimes dramatic change, and in reflecting more of hopes beyond our local communities, and in fact the hopes of our common humanity in our region.
So